Good evening, PSJ family. I'm Norma Garza, and I'm the Family and Community Engagement Director for PSJ. I want to thank you for being a part of our virtual Family Learning Academy. It is our vision for every PSJ student to be prepared to participate, compete, and excel in a global society to foster multi-generational prosperity. Welcome. Today we have our presenter, who is an LBJ assistant principal, Mr. Jorge Castilleja. And today's presentation is going to give us an overview of the district benchmark testing and strategies that you can use with your own children, parents. Once again, welcome, Mr. Castilleja, and we're ready for the presentation.
Thank you, Mrs. Garza. Good evening, everybody. Thank you very much for joining us in this evening and for allowing us to enter your homes. I really, really appreciate your time and the dedication that you have to assist your children in these coming up endeavors. So the presentation that I have for you today is gonna be dealing with the district benchmark testing. I'm gonna share with you a few points, tips, strategies, things that you can use. And I will also be able to answer some questions towards the end of the presentation. So again, thank you very much for allowing us to go into your homes, and I really appreciate your time. So let's begin. So again, this is the PSJ District Benchmark Testing, the All You Need to Know presentation for you. So let's discuss what we're gonna talk about today. So in today's discussion, we have a few key topics here. We're gonna be talking about the benchmark calendar, and that's gonna be for all grade levels, for elementary, middle school, and high school. We're also gonna be talking about some test-taking strategies, something that your kids can do, both to be physically and mentally prepared, and also some tips and strategies for you to help your kids out throughout the entire year. And I will also be sharing with you the state assessment participation form. This just got rolled out today, and it's gonna be very, very important for you guys to complete it as soon as you can, and give you more information about that once we get to that part of the presentation. And at the end, obviously, we always want to hear your feedback. You know, we want to answer those questions that you may have. There may be some questions, I'm going to be really honest right now, that I may not have the answer for you, okay? But if you give us your information, then we obviously will find an answer for you and give you that answer at a later time. All right, so usually the way that I start meetings, and this is something that your students are familiar with whenever they get to their classes, the virtual classes, the teacher shares virtual etiquette or virtual norms, right? So I have some for myself and for everybody here. So the virtual etiquette are the following. Number one, ask questions that will help the general audience. Number two, if you'd like to discuss something specifically for your family, so reach out to the school to arrange a meeting. That way we can meet the needs specifically for you and your child at that campus. And last but not least, and this one's super, super important in such a tumultuous time, is to stay positive. I understand that our families are struggling. You know, some of you, both of the parents work and the kids are at home alone, whether they're in the middle school. You've had to put on many hats. You're a counselor, you're a parent, you are a teacher, you are the chef at home, whatever role it is that you have in the house. We understand that it's very, very tough during this situation, during this pandemic. Yeah, we're ready to head out and be a little more social, something that we really miss. Especially for some of you that watch the Super Bowl alone, maybe this is the first time that you did that this weekend. But yes, it's very, very key to stay very, very positive. So if you can find anything right now that you can think of that you're blessed for, that you're excited to have, maybe something new came up for you, maybe you're celebrating a new baby that came to life, you bought a new home, whatever that may be, hang on to that. And that's what's going to drive you and propel you to continue to work hard for yourself and for your family. Again, I just want to introduce myself one more time. My name is Jorge Castilleja. I am an LBJ middle school assistant principal, amongst other hats that I had to put on this year as well. And I'm very excited to share some information with you guys. Okay, so on this first slide, and if you notice, I try to be a little inclusive of all of our schools and all of our feeder patterns here. So this one's a shout out to Alamo. District benchmark testing calendar, this one's for the elementary level. So if you notice on the right side here, I'm gonna read it out loud that way you're not so, if you're on a phone, it doesn't seem so small here. But there is there's the benchmark too that's coming up for the elementary levels. So in grades four, the benchmark is February 10th. I'm not too sure if that one got changed. Again, I'm at the middle school level. I know that at the middle school, it recently got changed because of the vaccinations that were going on. So you might want to double, triple check with your campus or monitor the social media to see if that writing benchmark changed for fourth grade. I mean, that's a grade level that does this writing one. But for the most part, the benchmark, the second benchmark will take place in March, beginning in March 9, 10, 11, and then May 18 and May 19 are benchmark two for the other grade levels here. And again, the May 18 and May 19, that one's for grades two. Those students will be testing in third grade as well, or as far as a STAR exam is concerned. So students will follow the same testing format as benchmark one. And if you've been sitting next to your child during this time, you notice that they have a PDF file that they have to open up, and they will have to answer or place their answers on DMAC. They will continue to follow that process, okay? It's very, very important that they add that information to DMAC. That way our teachers can see how our students are doing, and we get to see all this nice data and graphs so we can target instruction for your child. So this one is Escalante Colors, or PSJ Southwest feeder pattern colors here. This one is the middle school district benchmark testing calendar. And like I said, for writing, if you notice here, it says February 10th, which would be tomorrow. That writing benchmark got postponed until February the 16th, exactly a week from today. So some information is gonna be coming down through our teachers. I'm pretty sure they've been training these students already as to how to log into DMAC, how to use PDF, DocHub, all that information's rolled out. Remember that the writing benchmark only happens for seventh grade, and sixth and eighth grade only do the reading as far as ELA is concerned. Our Algebra 1 students, which are some seventh graders and eighth graders, they will have a benchmark on March 2nd. Then March 4th is science, March 5th is social studies, March 9th is math, and March 10th is reading. So if you notice, the beginning of March is gonna be testing week pretty much. So the benchmark two, again, will paint a better picture as to how students are performing in the class. And the teachers will have a better picture as to what should we address. You know, we're getting a lot closer to the actual STAR exam. So in this case, students will be using a website to take the exam. The format of this website is very, very similar to the STAR exam. Those students who have specific accommodations and modifications as part of their IEP or they're in 504. And if you have questions about that, the counselor can help you with that individually. So this website, it mimics that online testing that's gonna happen in May for the STAR exam. And so at any rate, still we have to have the information from that STAR or from this benchmark exam. These kids are still gonna have to put it on DMAC so we can again look at that data and address the needs of all of our students effectively. So this is benchmark number two. For benchmark number two for the high school. So February 16, the schedule for ELA for English 1, and that's grades 9 through 12. February the 18th for ELA 2 or English 2, that's also 9 through 12. Algebra 1 and US History are scheduled for March 9th. Remember that Algebra 1 is usually taken by our freshmen, and US History, it's usually our junior, so that's why they can be scheduled on the same day. March 10 is biology, and March 11 is a makeup day. So it is very, very important for you to try and have your students connect. We understand that there may be some extenuating circumstances, but to connect at the proper date so the students can actually take the exam when they're supposed to, and we're able to respond to that data a lot sooner and a lot quicker. The students will also be using PDF and DMAC. That stays the same. So the format is exactly the same as they did in benchmark number one. So test taking strategies and tips. So I divided it into two parts, right? Because they work together. Our body works together. If you're physically tired, then your mind will be tired at the same time. So they respond and they correlate. So on this left side, I included some physical readiness tips that your kids can follow. And obviously these are things that you used to hear even when you were in school, right, back in the day. They have to get a good night's sleep. It's very important. Now it's super easy for students to have the TV on and play Fortnite, get Roblox and all these other things. So we want to monitor and make sure that the students are getting a good night's sleep. Make sure to eat a healthy breakfast. Esos tacos de barbacoa, maybe not a good idea for that day. Kids will start feeling a little groggy, you know, towards maybe 30 minutes into the test. So something a little lighter, a fruit, you know, an apple a day keeps a doctor away, right? So that's something to consider as well. And this one's very important also to stay hydrated. Hydration really helps your mind connect with your body, and the kids will be able to recall information a little easier when students remain hydrated. Sometimes we confuse hydration and hunger, and your body kind of confuses that as well. For those students who take medication, please remember to take medicine as prescribed by the doctor. And if your student wears glasses or contacts, please make sure to wear those. We don't want them to be during the test having to squint, and maybe their head starts hurting, and that throws everything off very, very quickly. So that's the physical aspect here. Very simple tips and strategies that you can follow. Mental readiness. This is also very important, especially now during the pandemic. Wake up on time. That's very, very, very crucial. So if most of the students are like me sometimes when I'm very exhausted, set an alarm or maybe two, right? And maybe before you go to work, make sure they wake up or have them sleep in their jeans. You know, when it was the big game, I used to play baseball. When it was a big game, I would sleep sometimes in my uniform just because I was really excited, right? So make sure that they wake up on time. Pace yourself during the test. Nobody's rushing. It is a time test, but there's sufficient time for the students to finish that exam. So don't feel like they have to like rush through every single question. So just pace yourself, you know, and that's something they can practice right now during the benchmark and not on the actual star. Tackle one question at a time. Don't try to go to one through number 50 in 5 minutes, right? So it's one question at a time. If you move at that pace psychologically and mentally, you'll be ready to go. Don't look for the letter patterns of correct answers. A lot of our students are like, well, number 5, 6, 7, and 8, they were all letter B. Something must be wrong, right? Well, not necessarily. You know, you got to trust your gut. And so don't have your kids not really look at those patterns, because it may throw you off a little bit. Also, don't expect to know the answer to every single question. Just try your very best. And that's really the advice that we give our students. We motivate them, and just whatever it is that you've learned, whatever it is that you know, that's really what we want to see. Even if you don't know it, that's something that the teacher can use to maybe revisit or reteach that or teach it in a different way. Think positive and don't give up. You know, that's one of the things that if I don't get number 5, I'm going to be stuck on number 5 until I get it. Maybe it's time to jump to number 6, right? Like I said, they're not going to know every answer. They're not going to know every answer to every question. So they just got to remain positive and believe that they know the content, that they know the stuff. All they got to do now is put it on a paper, in this case on the computer, so that way the teacher can see that they've mastered that skill. And these 8 tips are especially for you, parents, and these can be working throughout the entire school year. So this is how you can help your child prepare. Prioritize attendance and homework. That's super important. I know a lot of the times the kids we see a little dot on the screen on Google Meets, but sometimes we don't know if they're actually logging in or not. So as best as you can, prioritize attendance and make sure that the kids are connected and engaged. Number 2, communicate with your child's teacher. That's super important. A lot of the teachers, they do have Class Dojo, Remind, maybe even through Google Classroom, email, text message. I don't know. Some teachers go above and beyond to maintain that communication with you. And you can also communicate via HAC in the sense that, oh, there's an assignment that got posted, the Home Access Center, by the way. That's an assignment that got posted, the grades are up, right? That's something, that's another way that you can communicate with your teacher. Talk to your child about test taking. A lot of the times they confuse with, or they get a little too stressed, like there's a benchmark coming up and they feel like it's the end of the world if I don't do well on this benchmark. Talk to them about it and let them know what it is, that it's just a way for teachers to measure how much they've learned. And if they don't know something, then that's what's gonna be shown, right, and seen on the actual exam. So talk to them about it, give them a little pep talk before the exam begins, which kind of goes with hand in hand with number four, offer positive reinforcement. Let them know that you believe in them. You know, one of the proudest moments in my life personally is my dad calling me and saying, Mijo, I'm very proud of you, right? So these kids, especially at the elementary level, middle school level, they want to belong and they want to feel like they're doing right by you, right? That they're trying their hardest and you're accepting them as a parent. So yeah, offer that positive reinforcement. Support healthy habits, again, correct sleeping times, you know, 6 to 8 hours, stay hydrated, eat well, exercise. I know I've probably put on some pandemic weight in this time, but we got to keep those healthy habits going for these kiddos. Give your child a study space. If it's a little corner in your house and in the living room, maybe in their room, give them some time some space for them to be to minimize distractions in the house. Because I know that, you know, what distracts me sometimes is my wife's cooking something, I can smell it, I'm hungry, or the cat, que se viene por aquí. I don't know, many distractions for these kiddos. So try to get a space where they can work independently and quietly. Keep testing in perspective, meaning keep in mind that there's testing that's happening, that there's another testing that's going to happen as far as the STAR is concerned, and communicate that to your kiddos. And last but not least, debrief after the test. Just go ask them after, like, hey, how did you feel about the test? How did you do? And it's okay. You know, if you tried your best, that's all we can ask for. Those kinds of words encourage the kids to do better next time around. So those are the 8 tips for you as parents. And last but not least, I wanted to share a few resources for you that you have available, which can be very, very helpful, especially right now when a lot of information is changing on a daily basis. I wanted to share with you the PSJ ISD district website. And in this website, there's a section that says assessment and accountability under the About Us. And there you'll see the testing and benchmark dates that I just shared with you. So they are available on the district website, and the testing department does try to update them regularly based on different changes that are happening throughout the state of Texas. And last but not least, I want to share the Texas Education Agency website. In this case, there is a spring 2021 state assessment guidance, which shows you all those changes to the actual STAR exam, to all the EOC exams that are happening in May. So you can find that, literally just Google that, spring 2021 state assessment, and just put like Texas or something, and it'll pop up for you. And that information is very valuable. You'll be up to date. That's the information that the district uses to update the information that we share with parents as well. Ms. Garza, we have some time for a Q&A. So if you can help me field some questions, I'd be more than happy to answer as many as I can. And if not, I'll find the answer for them. I'm looking at some here in the comment section. Wow, there's a lot of people. Welcome, everybody. Let's see. Okay, do we have any questions at this time? I'm looking at the...
I can go ahead and help you with that. Well, first of all, I want to thank all our audience. We have a lot of parents in the house tonight. And I do want to mention that we're in both pages. We're on PSJA Facebook and PSJA Parental page. Parents, in order to get credit for attending this session, because we are having, we're hosting it live, and they do allow us to have parent sessions live, go ahead and sign up on our registration page. If we don't have a registration page, just put your name or the name of your child, the school you're from, and we'll give you credit. So parents or parent educators will give you credit for attending today's session. But we'd like to start. I think one of the questions Mr. Robert Martinez asked is, how do you think our children are doing in class right now? How do you think, despite the pandemic, I want you to assure our parents that I think our students are doing fine. What do you see? If you're an assistant principal at your middle school, how do you think our children are doing as of right now? Robert Martinez asked that question.
Well, thank you for that question, Mr. Martinez. We've seen a whole range of results, a whole range of performance changes. You know, some of the students who didn't do so well on, you know, live and in-person instruction are excelling in the class, you know, but we've also seen the other side where some of the students who miss that interaction between one student and another, that friendship, you know, we've also seen them fall behind a little bit. But I use the word fall behind very, very lightly, because students are very, very resilient. You know, children are very resilient. They will definitely bounce back. You know, it's not like we're losing an entire year here. We're trying to connect with them as best as possible. And our engagement in some of the classes have been done very, very well. And a lot of it is credit to you. You know, some of you probably get home from work very late and then have to sleep a little late, you know, working with the kiddos. I know I do the same thing with my son, right, here at home. But we've seen a whole range of results going on. And really the only thing right now that we got to focus on is getting our kids to continue to be engaged. Our teachers are doing excellent. They've had to, honestly, this is pretty much their first year all over again, their first year of teaching all over again. So they've had to learn a lot in very, very little time. And so they've been very, very flexible with that as well. So our students are doing well, and we're going to see that in the benchmark results, and we'll see that at the end of the school year with our STAR and EOC exams.
Mm-hmm. So this is not a question particularly from one of our parents, but the question I have, Mr. Castilleja, so you all are going to have benchmarks. Are children going to expect it to return back to school, or do parents still have the option? I was just curious about that.
Mm-hmm. When it comes to benchmark, all of our campuses, we have a limited capacity right now with students currently on our campus, and that varies from one school to another. As far as the benchmark is concerned, everything is done online. You know, mm-hmm. if they've been doing, having remote instruction, virtual remote instruction, they're going to continue to do that. When it comes to the actual TELPES and STAR assessments, the actual mm-hmm. state assessments, these students will be doing them online. However, they will have to come into campus, right? And what we're doing is, at the campus level, we're trying to play with the logistics a little bit so we can minimize the contact between students and really prevent and mitigate any type of disease spreading, you know, as far as COVID mm-hmm. is concerned. But parents always have an option to do that. As a matter of fact, if we can share the link to the participation form that is released by our district just today. So you'll see the link right now popping up, as you can see it there. Every parent in the district will have to fill this one out. And the login is going to be their Home Access Center login. And in that login, what they'll see is they'll see all of their students' names, the kiddos' names, and all the assessments that they have to take. So parents do have the option of allowing them to come to school, whether it's taking a test online or on paper. But right now, priority is going online to minimize that contact between, you know, people. But they also have the opportunity to opt out if they feel that it's too much of a threat, it's too much of a danger to send their kids to school and have them get tested, right, for TELPIS and STAR. We do encourage parents to fill out this form. We would like 100% participation. That way we can play with logistics and meet the needs of all of our students.
Great. So right here, parents, if you've noticed, Mr. Castilleja has shared the link. You can indicate if your child will or will not participate in this year's state assessments. And that's really important to fill out. And so that we can have some data and we can know how many parents will be sending their children. We will follow all the safety protocols. So right there, we have, I think that's about it. We have that link and we're concluding our presentation right now. Parents, I want to advise you that at 6:30, we have our Spanish session with Mr. Jorge Castilleja. If you would like to attend or let any other family member attend, or your own children can attend the session also as well. Next week, I want to invite you because we are going to have our district's psychologists and also we have our counselors who are going to present on anxiety. And so if you have been dealing with anxiety during this pandemic and you want some tips, we have our PSJ personnel from our SLS team that will be presenting next Tuesday evening, which is February the 16th. The time right now is 6:27 p.m. We have concluded our session. We want to thank Mr. Jorge Castilleja, assistant principal from LBJ, and his principal, Mrs. Linda Soto. We'll also like to thank our superintendent and our school members for making this available for you all to help you all with anything you need. Thank you. Good night. And we'll see you at 6:30 in our Spanish session.
Thank you very much, everybody. Mm-hmm.